Good morning, Saints. This is Wilbur Robinson, pastor of the Grace Temple Church of the Apostolic Faith, located at 1 Coleman Avenue, Cherry Hill, New Jersey, 08034. I'm coming to you again today. I want to give you another little nugget of truth. I want you to try and encourage us as the members of the body of Christ that we examine ourselves real carefully to make sure that we're doing the things that we should be doing for God. He's the only one we owe is the Lord Jesus Christ. He's the only one. God created us. Christ died for us. He made a way for us to live in peace down here. I'm telling you, as wild as it is around us, in Christ Jesus, there's peace. And I just want to share that with you because I'm living it. I'm living within the turmoil that's going on in the world, but I have the peace of Christ ruling in my heart. Takes away fear, takes away doubt, takes away anything that is going to question who God is and what God is able to do. So we want to make sure that we're doing these things, that we can get fully in Christ Jesus so that we can truly rest in him and live a nice, peaceful life here on earth, giving people an example of who Christ can be in them if they come this way. So I just wanted to share with you tonight or this morning so that you can get a little closer or hopefully take it to heart. And if you're not feeling real comfortable in Christ Jesus, it's not his fault, okay? It's just not his fault because he said he brought peace, you know? He said, my peace I leave with you. You know, he said he give it to us, not as the world giveth, you know, but he gives us peace that passes all understanding. There's no way that people can understand what it is we're doing with a peaceful countenance in the midst of this wicked generation of people. We have a president who is a bigot. He's just a hardcore evil man. He's got the evil spirit in him. It was prophesied that at the end of his second term, if he wins again, he'll be a praying man. That's yet to be seen. But anyway, I don't want to get off on that. I just wanted to go into the Word today. I want us to hear what the Bible says in Colossians, the book of Colossians chapter 3. And I want us to take a look at it and listen real good and take heed to what's being said here and understand that God can give you just what it is you're looking for in his son, Jesus Christ. Everything that we need is in him. So let us look at it. All right, let's go. I want you to go into the book with me. We're going to be in Colossians, the third chapter. And I'm going to read through the whole thing. Stop here and there to give you a little bit of it, you know, just a little bit of what the Lord has given me. And I want to share it with you so that we can just grow together in Christ. I don't expect you to be where I am, and I may not be where you have, what you have achieved in Christ. But what I do know is that what I have learned, I can live up to that. And that's a struggle. You know, the devil's not going to let me do what God wants me to do. You know, he's not going to do it. It's my job to work out my salvation. So my perfection in Christ, even though I still have flaws in this old sinful body of mine, I can live up to what I have heard. And I'm struggling to do that, but that is my desire. And that's what I'm saying to you. You have to have a desire to live for God. And if you have that desire, you're going to resist the devil. And you're going to press toward the Lord. Okay. So here we go. In the Colossians 3, verse 1. Now listen to this. I'm talking to everyone now who has been born again. That's who I'm talking to. The body of Christ. The ones who have been, number one, realized that they were wrong. Repented of their sins. Asked God to forgive them for their sins. They were water baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission, the removing of those sins. And they were filled with God's Spirit, which was the new birth, and which is what brought us into the body of Jesus Christ. That's who we're talking to today. Now, what you're going to hear some things that it doesn't seem like it should be talking to the body of Christ. But we're still going through. This salvation thing is a process. And it's going to take time for us to walk in a perfect way for the Lord. And it's going to take our decision, our willful decision to follow Christ, stop doing what we used to do and start doing what God wants us to do. And when the devil comes, we have to resist him. He'll back off and then we can get a little closer to the Lord. So listen to the book and let us get closer to the Lord. Okay, Colossians 3:1. It says, if ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. One of the psalmists said, I will look to the hills from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. This is what we want to do, says God. Keep your eyes on the Lord. Everybody listen. And keep your eyes on the Lord. Here's what it says again. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above and not all those things on the earth. Listen, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Listen. What is he talking about being risen with Christ? Listen, saints of God, when we were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we were buried with him. And just as Christ was raised up a new man, look, he went down one way and came up a new way. That's what happened to us. Believe it or not, when you repented and was water baptized in Jesus' name, you went down one way, full of sin, with that old Adamic nature on you. When you went down in the water and you came up out of that water, trust me, you were not the same person that went down. That old nature, that old sinful nature stayed in the pool or in the water wherever you were buried. And the blood that was in that water from Jesus Christ, that is what cleansed you. And when you came up out of that water, you came up a new man or a new woman, a new individual. Trust me, you may not have felt different, but you were different. Because it's in here. And if you have then been risen with Christ, set your affection on things above, the things that come down from God and not on the things of the earth. He says, set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Listen to the Bible. What are you talking about? You are dead. Your sins, you died to sin. You died to self. And now you have come up to be a new person in Christ Jesus. There is a new spirit in you. You have taken on the characteristics of God himself. Before you went down in that water, you had taken on the sinful nature that was brought upon the world when Adam sinned and broke his relationship with God. So every man, woman, boy, and girl who was born into the world after that fall was born in sin and shaped in iniquity. That's all we knew. And the only way that we could get freed from that is that somebody had to pay a price, and the price was blood, and the blood had to be pure. And there was no man who could do that, so God took it upon himself. He made him a body. He got in that body. He taught man how to live for God, and then he gave his life, paid the price, took on the death that we were supposed to have, that was supposed to come upon us for our sinfulness, and God did it for us. So now, when we accept that, when we got baptized, we came out of the water, and now we're new creatures. Just believe it. This is the word. God won't lie. You are a new creature in Christ. So now you should be looking for things from God and not from the world. For you are dead, and your life is hid with God, with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. You got to know something. There's going to be a judgment, and the righteous are going to be judged first. The household of faith is going to be judged first for our righteous deeds. So when we rise up, we're going to be judged, and we're going to be found faultless, blameless, because we're in Christ Jesus. That's the only way that we can get through to heaven. It get through Christ Jesus. To understand something, Jesus said, no man can come unto the Father but by me. The only way we're going to get to God and that heavenly promise, that inheritance that was promised to the believers, is to go through Jesus Christ. We're in Christ now. Why? Let's go back again. You were repented. You were baptized. You received the Holy Ghost. And now you are no longer who you were. You are now the property of Jesus Christ. Paul called himself a slave. He was duty bound to do God's will. So let's go a little further. It says, mortify, put to death, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. This is what we used to do in the world. Fornication. We did this. Uncleanness. This is immoral behavior. That's what that uncleanness is. Inordinate affection. No real affection. Everything we did it for so we could get some type of benefit for ourselves. So it was inordinate affection. You know, this thing about what these young people and old people, too, are out here calling themselves falling in love. This they ain't falling in love. They're falling in lust. You know, the young men are telling the girls how cute they are, and the girls are telling the young men how cool they are. And it's just a lust. It's not love. It's not that sincere love that if a man loves a woman and a woman loves a man and they decide I want to live the rest of my life with this individual, that's when they tie up. But they're not doing that today. Inordinate affection. People don't care about people. Only people in Christ, and that's where we're supposed to be. I'm saying, only people in God or in Christ have that real affection, but there's some of us in this way who have not come up to that yet. And I'm telling you, we're going to have to get to that place where we love those who are part of the body of Christ more than we love ourselves. What are you talking about, preacher? Because we have to love God more than we love ourselves. And we can't love God if we can't love God's people. Listen to what I'm saying. Understand something, saints of God. It's a lot. We got to give up a lot. You have to give up a lot. Excuse me. And this is what the scripture is telling us here. Mortify, therefore, your members which are upon the earth. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence. That's evil desires. Those lustful desires. That's what it is. And covetousness. You got to stop wanting everything that somebody else has. Be satisfied with what you have because God has given you what you have for you. And if you're thankful for those things, he's going to give you more. He knows what you want. He knows what's in your heart. He knows the desires of your heart. But a righteous life will allow him to unfold all those blessings that he has that he says will overtake you. But you got to be in Christ and you got to be doing God's will, God's way. So it goes on to say evil concupiscence and covetousness, which is idolatry. Listen to this. For which things sake, the wrath of God cometh on the children of disobedience. The children of disobedience. The wrath of God is coming on the children of disobedience. Who are they? They're the ones we just identified here in verse 5. We used to do those things, but in Christ Jesus, we don't do those things anymore. Listen to the 7th verse. It says it in the 7th verse. In the which ye also walked sometime when ye lived in them. See, this is just telling the truth, just flat out telling the truth. We all did some dirt when we were in the world because we didn't know any better. So that now that we're in Christ, again, if ye then be risen with Christ, now we're going to take on a new life. We're going to take on a new approach to life. We're going to start doing things God's way and not our own way. In the which ye also walk sometimes when ye live in them. But now, he also put off all these. Now, saints of God, I want you to listen to these and pay attention because these are things that we need to do. These are the things that we have to fight. We have to fight because the devil is trying to make us do all the things that we're going to be told not to do. He's telling us, the word is telling us to put off these things because these things that we're getting ready to read here in this 8th verse are things that were easy for us to do before we were risen again. With Christ. Now listen to the 8th verse. But now ye also put off all these. Anger. Come on now. Wrath. Ain't nothing good about it. I haven't said anything good yet. Malice. Blasphemy. Filthy communication out of your mouth. And that filthy communication is not always using profanity. That is it. But that's not all profanity. It's speaking evil of your brothers and your sisters. It's saying it's gossip. It's lying. It's falsifying things. Come on here. Come on. Deceitfulness, Look, this thing is in your heart and it comes out your mouth. Because that's how people know what kind of character you are. They know what's coming out of you. They know what's in you. So these things aren't, this is not godly. These things are not godly. Listen to this. Filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another. Listen to this, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds. Do you hear it? The old man is in the water. those old sin, that old sin nature is still in the water, and it does not, God has no record of those sins anymore. The only thing that's being counted and being written down now is what we do from the time we came out of that water until we go before the Lord in judgment. Do you hear what I'm saying? So stop living in the past and stop thinking that you have to go back and do those things. You have a brand new person on the inside. That person that's on the inside can't do the things that you used to do in the world. And the only way that you can go back and do those things is that the devil, who is still present in the flesh, is trying to get you back to where you used to be. And God is pulling you to him, and Satan is trying to pull you back to the, to his way of living. So be careful. Pay attention. And understand that you are in a warfare. You are in fighting for your life. Lie not one to another, seeing that you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man. Listen to this, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. Listen to this, Saint of God. We are renewed in knowledge. We did not know who God was. We did not know how to live for God. We did not know how to conduct ourselves in this old body, because we were shaped, raised up in sin, shaped in iniquity, and all we knew was sin. Huh? And the new man now came and took away the sin nature and put in a righteous nature. And the Holy Ghost has come to lead us in all righteousness. Good gracious, we can do this thing. But you have to yield to the Holy Ghost. You have to yield to the new man and stop going back to the old ways. The old ways were going to guarantee us death. The wages of sin is death. Huh? But the gift of God, the Holy Ghost that's in you, it leads you to eternal life. Oh, come on now. Listen to this thing. And listen. And it says that put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. And who created us? It certainly wasn't Satan. It was God himself. And God created you to be just the way you came into the world. Listen, there is nothing that God wanted you to do to yourself after he brought you in here but follow him. He created you to live for him, to glorify him, and to be a subject to him. We see man is such an evil beast, because the man wants to change with God, that he's not happy with the way God made it. He wants to be like somebody else. That's why the scripture just said, set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth. Why? Because on the earth, we're looking at other people. We're looking at other situations. We start looking at people wanting to be like them. We have idols. We make idols of people and things like that. No. You are supposed to focus on the Lord. And you're not supposed to change anything. You're supposed to allow the Lord to grow up in you just the way he made you. Huh? Yes, sir. Listen, I wanted to be, and listen, I used to tell the saints this, but I'm just telling you, this is what I wanted. I wanted to be 6 foot, 6 foot 6. That's what I wanted to be. 6 foot 6, and I wanted to weigh 240 pounds, because at that point, I thought I would be a better football player, right? And I never made it. I never made 6 feet. I made 5'10 3/4". Now, the 3/4 is not that important, but it got me closer to 6 feet. You know what I'm saying? And I did get close to 240, but I got to 235 in a 5'10" frame. So that wasn't, there wasn't the muscles then. The muscles were all covered up with fat. But what I'm saying is I wanted what I wanted, but God made me what I am. So now I'm happy. I'm happy where I am right now. And I want you to understand that you are right where God wants you to be right now. All he wants us to do now is to start living a more spiritual, godly life. Don't worry about your physical appearance. Start dressing up that inner man. That's what God wants. And that's what he's telling us here. And it's telling us here that we have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. We learn these things through God's word. Huh? Where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision nor uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free, but Christ is all and in all. So listen, we don't care what you were or what you are. Huh? You are a person. You are a person. Were created by God. So now we have the ability in us to love those who are like us and those who are not like us. Why? Because we're all God's creation. Huh? We're all one. There's one human family. We all came from one man. And we have no reason to dislike or hate anybody else. There's this, you know, this all this racial tension and stuff, you know, that's not godly. Trust me, it's not godly. God created everybody. Everybody who came into the world through that source that God provided, and that was Adam and Eve. So forget about this difference between neither Greek nor Jew, circumcision or uncircumcision, barbarian, Scythian, bond or free. But Christ is all and in all. Listen to the 12th verse. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved bowels of mercies, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another. If any have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, so also do ye. And listen to me now. This is written, and this is what we're supposed to be doing. And if you have a problem with any one of these things, then you need to get on your knees and ask God to work on you. You need to ask God to work on you. Look, I got things that I'm asking the Lord to work on me, because I got some things that are going on in my life. You know, a lot of them are mental, you know, but they shouldn't be there. And I'm asking the Lord to work on these things. I don't want none of that junk. I don't want the Lord, when I stand before the Lord, I don't want him to have to tell me what about this and what about that. I want that stuff to be cleaned up, but only he can do it. If I could have done it, he wouldn't have had to die. But I have to get these things straightened out. Now, here's the key. This is important. I want them to get straightened out. Because like Paul said, with my mind, I'm going to serve the Lord. And with my flesh, I serve sin. But what I want to do is serve God. So those things that the devil is trying to keep in my life, I'm fighting against those things. And that's the only way I'm going to make this journey, is I got to fight against it. I got to resist the things that the enemy is pulling me to or back to, because I didn't have no trouble back in the world. But when I rose to walk in a new life. So I'm a new man, and if you've been born again, you are a new person, and you need to live like a new person in Christ. This is important, and I'm going to read it again. Put on, therefore, as the elect of God, and you are elect of God. You are chosen by God to be in God's kingdom. So he chose you. You had nothing to do with it. Before the foundation of the world, you were to be in him. Now take advantage of it. And the devil can't offer you anything. He can't offer you anything but death. God has said, I made a way for you to live for me. And if you do that, all that you need in life, I'm going to provide for you. And I'm going to bring you all the way from where you are into heaven and give you what you have inherited. And that's eternal life. Listen, put on therefore as the elect of God, holy and beloved bowels of mercy. You know the bowels is the depth of your soul. That's from the very depth of your soul. That's what God had. God so loved the world. It was just in him. He just could not allow mankind to die without making a way for him to live. Goodness. That's the spirit that we have to allow to work in us toward everybody. Because we just heard in the 11th verse, there is no difference between all these different peoples, these different nationalities and races. So we're going to put on, therefore, as the elect of God, holy and beloved bowels of mercies, kindness. You can be kind. Look, if you can be kind to people that you like, you can be kind to anybody, because that spirit of kindness is in you. So just be kind. Just be kind. I mean, you want people to treat you kindly, so you be kind. And if you be kind, you'll find kindness coming back to you. Listen to the book. Humbleness of mind. Stop trying to be so much and just be little and low and meek. Just don't have to have so much attention. Don't have to be first. You don't have to have the best. Make do with what you have and thank God for it. Listen, meekness. Meekness. Long-suffering. Listen, forbearing one another. Put up with something, saints of God. And let me say something to you. You don't have to make an effort to do this. That spirit is in you to do in you what he's saying right here. All you have to do is submit to it. That's it. Just submit to God and let God be God in you. You don't have to do anything. You know, our elder used to tell us he didn't want to have to make himself love you. Love was in him. So just let love do what love does. Let brotherly love continue. That's what the Bible says. It's in you if you've been risen with Christ, and you have been. So act like it. All right, let's go. Forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man have a quarrel against any, even as Christ forgave you, and you know he did, because you are a rank sinner, thank you very much, and you know he forgave you, so you are obligated to forgive everyone who has ever offended you. And I don't care what they did and how many times they did it. Peter asked the Lord, said, how many times should I forgive my brother? Seven times seven? And the Lord said, seventy times seven. That means, when in effect, every time you're offended, you forgive. Huh? Yes. And you better do it. Huh? You better do it. Don't let the devil trick you. And above all these things, put on charity, which is love, which is the bond of perfectness. Listen, love covers a multitude of faults and sins. Love, that's God's love. God so loved us that he overlooked our sins. So you have to so love your brothers and sisters that you can overlook their sins. Now listen, say to God, listen, I'm going to say something here. You know, we're quick to judge alcoholics and drug addicts and homosexuals. We're quick to judge them. And they are wrong. But we have to have love for them that we want to do something about them. And you can't do something with everyone, but you can pray that God will open up their understanding. Do you hear what I'm saying? Instead of judging them, instead of being so critical of them, you can pray for them that God will open up their understanding. They're just being they're being manipulated and overrun by the spirit of the Antichrist. That's all it is. And they don't realize, huh? Because what did we say here up here about the knowledge? See if I can find it, because we've been renewed in the knowledge. I don't see it, but you know, we just read it up here. Okay, 10th verse. But I put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him. So look, we didn't have the knowledge. Huh? We may not have done some of what they did. I did some of what there's out there. But the Lord brought me in, and now I know better. Huh? Pray for him. Huh? Stop being so critical. Stop being so judgmental, and pray for him. God saved you, and he can save them. Okay, just going to finish up right now. I want you to get this thing. Understand that we are new. We're not like we used to be. We're new. We are new. We are new. We're brand new people in the man who created us, and it's because of him and nothing we did. And then listen, above all these things, put on charity, which is the bond of perfectness, and let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body. Let brotherly love continue. Let the love of God rule in your hearts. Thank you, God. He's in there. Goodness gracious. He's in there. Now listen, we're in this world, but we're no longer of the world. Let God take over in your life and live. Huh? Hey, you should walk in sin, you're dead. You're a dead man walking. Huh? As long as you resist this and allow wrath and anger and malice and all that stuff to be in you, even after you've been born again, you got a major problem. Because we talked about last week, willful sin. To do these things now, these are willful decisions that we're going to make to do. What we read up here, up in the 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th verse, if we're doing any of that stuff, that's willful, and you got a problem with that. So now he's saying here, let the peace, goodness gracious, that God gives us, that saints of God, you don't know the joy that comes with the peace of Christ in the midst of this terrible situation that we're faced with. Now, many of us haven't been in nothing this bad. You know, the old timers went through the Great Depression and went through all these different things, but this is something that the United States and the world hasn't gone through something like this in a long time. This is, the devil is out there, brother. The devil's out there. And the Lord is allowing it to happen to get people to start turning back to him. So you just, it's yourself. If you got this spirit in you, let this spirit live in you. And you do what God is calling you to do. And stop being so hard-headed and evil and selfish about how people treat you. Don't worry about how people treat you. Treat people like God treated you. Yeah, he saved you. Okay. And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful. That's what I'm talking about. Listen, I'm going to finish up here. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Keep him at the forefront of your life, and you're always going to be able to impart some type of comforting thing to somebody else. That's what letting the peace of Christ rule in your heart. And when if Christ is ruling in your heart, then the spirit of Christ is going to come out and it's going to get on people. And people are going to know something has happened in you, because there's going to be something happening in you that they're going to want to know more about it and to give you an opportunity to testify. Listen, 17th verse. And whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Now, saints of God, listen to this. Whatever we do in word or deed, we're to do it in the name of the Lord Jesus. We cannot do verses 8, 9. Okay, especially 8 and 9. We can't do those in the name of the Lord Jesus because those are contrary to the Spirit of God. We can't, look up here when we do verse 5, mortify therefore the members, we can do that in the name of the Lord Jesus, because that's the only way they're going to get mortified, is that through the name and the power of the Lord Jesus. So it's saying here, whatsoever you do in the word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. You can, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus. Whatever you do, whenever you make a decision, always go to the Lord for counsel. He is a wonderful counselor. He will give you the right decision. When you start looking at the world, we're not going to go into this about, I'm going to read it so you can hear. This is, husbands and wives have duties too. I'll read that. But the point that I wanted to get out to us today, the little nugget, is if ye therefore have been risen with Christ, that is what we want to know. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above. Mm-hmm. That's what it says, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. And number two, it says, set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth. Listen to me. If you set your affection on things of above, you're going to look to God to see what God wants for you. And I'm going to tell you something now. Just listen to me. God doesn't want us tattooing, decorating our flesh, because the flesh is going back to the dust. The spirit is going back to God. But God wants the spirit to be clean, pure, and righteous when it goes back to him, so that he can take you in to his kingdom and into eternal life with him. If that spirit and that soul is dirty, having repented, continue to walk in sin, that spirit is going back to the Lord and is going to be judged. And from that judgment, that spirit is going to be cast into the lake of fire and be tormented for eternity. Okay? So that's something you think about it. This flesh, look, this is just a mess, this flesh. This is going back to the dust. So why beautify it? The Lord said he wanted to beautify you. You were a spirit of meekness. He wanted to put a quiet, meek and a quiet spirit in us. He don't want us being decorated and worshiping us and idolizing the flesh. That's what I'm talking about. You can't decorate yourself in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't put on lipstick and makeup, jewelry, tattoos. You can't do all that. These brothers with these long hair, it's a shame for a man to have long hair. That's what the Bible says. So you can't do that in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. God would clean you up. This is what we used to do. God would clean you up. I got off on that because I just want you to understand. What we do We need to consult the Lord's word and find out if indeed what I'm choosing for myself is acceptable to God. Think about it. All right now. Because it's going to come up again. It's coming up again. It ain't just going to stop here. It's coming up again. So listen, it says again, and whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by him. Now just listen. I'm going to read to you. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as it is fit in the Lord. Listen, submission to, listen, the man is the head of the wife. Huh? That's the order God set. But it does not mean that the man is the ruler of the wife. No, they're equal partners. Huh? He runs the show, and she submits to him, and she helps him run the show. Understand me? That this doesn't give the man the right to bully or dominate or to control the wife. No, the wife, actually, the wife is smarter than him. I believe one definition, I don't know where I heard somebody say this. I never read it or saw it for myself. But it says a helpmeet. God gave Adam a helpmeet. And a helpmeet is one that is wiser or stronger than the man. So women play a big part in a family, in a relationship. So wives, submit to your husband. If you submit to your husband, you're going to have less trouble out of him than if you fight him. Okay, and look what you have to do of husbands. You ain't getting away. It says, husbands, love your wives and be not bitter against them. Okay, your wife is going to be cantankerous sometimes. Huh? Your wife's going to be moody. That's the way women are. But you have to put up with it. Now, that's why when you get married, you got to get married for more than the beauty. Get married for more than the intimacy. You got to get married for life. I want to spend the rest of my life with this woman because, well, for better or for worse. Okay, so you got to take the good and the bad. Okay, the bad that I deal with in my marriage, is the good far outweighs the bad. And the same way with my wife. I know I'm good to my wife. I'm a pain in her butt sometimes. But I know she gets more out of me than bad. She gets more good out of me than bad. Because we work together 51 years, 52 years in December. So we've been together. So again, wives, submit. Submit yourself. Because God made it that way. And husbands rule, And live with the wives, one scripture says according to knowledge, but it says here, be not bitter against them. Children, obey your parents. If you listen to your parents, you won't be getting out there having sex before you get married. You won't be out there doing drugs. You won't be out there shooting needles and smoking and drinking. You won't be doing the things that the Bible speaks against because your parents are going to give you good counseling. Now, again, let's go back to the parents. Parents, you have to be parents. Listen to what it's going to say to you, fathers. And this goes for you two mothers. Fathers, he said, wait a minute, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well-pleasing unto the Lord. And then one scripture says that the children obey your parents because this is the first commandment with promise. Huh? What is that promise? That your life may be long upon the earth. Huh? So if you're going to be contrary to your parents, you're going to get cut off somewhere along the line. And you may not live as long as you would if you had been obedient to your parents. So listen to this. Fathers, 21st verse. Fathers, provoke not your children to anger, lest they be discouraged. Huh? We got a responsibility here. We can't just bully people. We got to understand who we are living with, who we are raising. Everybody has got a different personality. Even though we're born and we're coming to the same family, the same blood, each one of us are a little different. That's why the husband has to learn to deal with the wife. The wife has to learn how to deal with the husband. She has a role. He has a role. The children have a role. And the parents have a role to the children. So we have to learn how to do this in God's way. Servants, obey in all things your masters according to the flesh, not with eye service as men pleasers, but in singleness of heart, fearing God. What are you talking about? Do your job. Don't take advantage of your boss. Do your job. Servants, serve as if you're serving the Lord. That's what he's talking about. Listen to it. And whatsoever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto men. Everything we do should be as if we're doing it to the Lord. Why? Because the Lord said, what you've done to at least one of these little ones, you've done it also unto me. Huh? Everything we do, we're doing it as unto the Lord, especially now that we are in the body of Christ. Listen again. Knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of an inheritance, for ye serve the Lord Christ. But he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong which he hath done, and there is no respect of person. Listen to me. If you sin, I don't care how good you think you are, if you sin and you don't come and do God's will, God's way, but he that doeth wrong shall receive for the wrong. And if you get rewarded for the wrong, you wind up in the lake. And there's no respect of person. So it doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what status you have in life. It doesn't matter what you are. You can have a, you can be a preacher. You can be a singer. You can be an entertainer. Whatever you are, you have to come God's way. And if you do, you'll get an inheritance of eternal life in Christ Jesus. If not, you're going to get eternal life. Actually, it's not. It's the second death. That's that final separation from God. And you're going to be cast into a lake of fire. And you're going to burn and be tormented forever. So that's it for today. I just wanted to drop that off to you. I hope you got something out of it. What I would suggest you do is go back and take your time and read through it again. I kind of rushed it through to get it out to you. But I want you to read it through again and pay attention to what you're reading and ask God to open up and give you understanding. And understand that every time we do something, if it's good or it's bad, it's being done as unto the Lord. So if I'm involved in adultery or I'm involved in fornication and I'm supposed to be a born-again believer, that means I'm bringing my born-again, I'm bringing Christ into this adulterous or fornicating situation. If I lie, I'm bringing Christ into the lie. If I'm mistreating somebody, if I don't forgive, I'm bringing Christ into that spirit. So we want to make sure that we don't do that, because whatsoever we do in word or deed, do it heartily as unto the Lord. And whatsoever we do in word or deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. So keep it in mind, Saint God. Live, let's live. Let's not die and go to hell. Let's live. God has brought life, and he brought it more abundantly. Take advantage of it. God will. We'll see you again. And until then, be blessed and stay prayerful and look to the Lord for everything.